Hey guys. Oh, now you decided to close, right? I thought I was interfering with the door. I said, well, I'm not keeping you from closing. My wheelchair wasn't keeping the door from closing. So anyway, hey guys, how you doing? They're having a meeting in that room, and I couldn't think of any place to talk, so I thought, hey, why not come out here? It's a little hot out here, but anyway, at least I'll be able to talk and not have to worry about bothering anybody. Anyway, I wanted to continue talking about...
Hey, Jim.
How you doing? And the door opens again. Okay, I guess that's going to be a continuation here. Or it could be a running gag, I don't know. Okay, alright, we should close this again. Alright. Anyway, I want to continue talking about... my dad, Bob Liftin, and Regent Sound. Now, one thing that I wanted to do is correct something that I had said in a previous video. And that was the address of CBS. Okay, I said that CBS was on West 57th Street. And I realized, I thought... it was 57th Street, it might be 57th Street, but something tells me it's 52nd Street, not 57th. I could look, I don't know if I'd bother, oh, that's a nice breeze, to look that up, whether CBS was over on 52nd or 57th, I don't know. It was near 12th Avenue, that much I remember. It was like right toward the end, toward the river, is what I remember. Okay, and speaking about Screen Gems EUE on East 44th, there is something I did want to talk about. One of the wonderful privileges that I had gotten while working at my dad's studio. Before I started working in the dupe room, I was doing deliveries. And Jesus has been working with my dad for the longest time, and he was like, I think, one of the most trusted employee my dad had. And so he was basically doing deliveries, and then when I started working there after college, I went with him for the deliveries, because while he was going to be devoting his time with breaking down the studio after a session, or setting up the studio before a session, and other duties like that. Wanted to be relieved of the responsibility of doing deliveries, so now it's going to be fall on me. So I would go with him making these deliveries, so I saw where these places were. So if I had to go, let's say, to Macy's, I would know exactly where to go, what floor to go to, what office to go to. CVS, I'd go right in with them, drop the package at the front desk. I wouldn't be allowed to go further than that, which I didn't mind. And the big thrills was going to Screen Gems EUE. Now, I would always go up the elevator to the floor where Screen Gems EUE would videotape an episode of one of the soap operas. And I don't remember, oh, that's a nice cool breeze coming from inside. Wow, how's that contrast? You get used to me out here, then you think, oh, until a cool breeze from inside blows on you when the door opens. So anyway, I don't remember the soap opera that was being filmed at Screen Gems EUE, But I remember one of them was, and my job was doing the broadcast cards, and we would buy Scotch broadcast card tapes, reels of those, from the 3M company, I forget where they were. And we would pick up a whole bunch of these reels of broadcast card. Oh, that's a nice breeze. Ooh, that's a nice cool breeze. And so after I edited all the cues and put a little 3-inch tone at the beginning of which at each one as a beep, then I would make a transfer on the whole reel onto a reel of this broadcast cart, and then I would wind it up on a core, put the core on the cart loader, which I hated doing because then I had to take the end of the two ends of each cue, splice them together as a loop, put the spit, put the little disc in the cart, close it up, screw it up, put a label on it, put the box, send it out to CBS or Screen Gems EUE. And so I just knew that this was my work. And once they're done and they're at the front desk to be delivered, I never see them again. But once I did, of course, when more cues come in, then I grab another empty cart, load each cart, and do the whole thing all over again. But once I'm done working on a cart, I never see them again. That is, until one day I made a delivery at Screen Gems EUE, and I didn't even expect this, and whoever I brought them to said to me, "We're about to shoot a scene, and I'm so glad you brought the carts here. Would you like to come in and take a look at how we do an episode?" And I said, sure, I'd love to. So, oh, nice booth. Uh-oh, I see a cobweb. I gotta tell Bill about that. That doesn't look too good out there. Out here, I should say. So anyway, I went with him. What the hell is that, a bat? No, a butterfly, I think. Okay. All the things you see out here that you don't think about, you don't pay that much attention to.
Hi.
And cool breeze again. Oh, that feels nice. Hey, that's good air conditioning. Wow. So I went with him to the little audio booth. Uh-oh, I better stay in here. Shade from the sun. I went into the audio booth, and when I walked in there, I saw all the carts that I did and the Regent logo on every label, and I was like, wow, this is where they end up. And I was like, did I do these? I know I did those. Yeah, I recognize the title. And they're about to shoot a scene, and I hear a bell go off, and quiet on the set, you know, and all that stuff. And then we're looking down at the scene being done on the stage, and we're up a bit. I think we're like 2 floors up, but this is this huge ceiling, probably about 2 stories tall, with all the lights and everything. And I was gonna watch them do a scene, and I was gonna watch the audio man do the music scores, right? So, the music engineer, you know, he has all the carts that he needs for the scene, and according to the script, he knows which cart to be played and when. You know, what is the audio, what is the piece of dialogue that is his cue to hit the button? And that brought me back to my Krupke days at summer camp, when I had to remember the line before mine is my cue to speak as Officer Krupke. I want to say story from Camp Emerson. So he had his cues on when to hit that button, and I watched him do that. And he would put the card in that I did. Yes, I did. And he would follow the script, and right when he's supposed to hit that button, boom, he hits the button, and the cue plays, and under the dialogue, of course. And I say, yeah, I remember that score. I remember that cue. I worked on that one. And hey, it worked out good. I did a good job. I did a good job putting the 1K tone at the head of that, you know. So that was my experience there. Okay. Now fast forward ahead a little bit. Now, I don't remember when he did this, but one day he went to a recording engineer show, sort of like an symposium or some kind of expo or show where different vendors would have innovations, and they would show their wares at different tables and to anyone and everyone who'd be interested. And my dad, oh, he was like a kid in a candy store. I have never, ever seen my dad so happy and so giddy when that's all you gotta do. It's just hit the button and go in. I thought there was a code. I thought there was a keypad on the outside of the building. Huh. I just learned something today. Okay. Because I'm like, where's the keypad, you know? It's, oh, you gotta tap in a code to get in, you know? Anyway, so like I said, my dad was a kid in a candy store. He just, oh man, he was a kid. He was so happy and so giddy, you know? And so he let me loose, and you know, and so I looked around the tables, and there were two tables that caught my attention. There was one of the Ampex Custom Duplicating Services, and they were giving out free cassettes that demonstrated what the Ampex Custom Duplicating Services can do. And on one side of the cassette, and on the other side was musical selections that can show how clear and almost like a Blu-ray version of audio. Okay, so you know how clear Blu-ray is, right? And you know how sharp the image is, that you can actually read a panel and the lettering on the panel. Well, just think of how clear that is on audio. There's no static. There's no hissing. There is no audio ambience. The output is so crystal clear. And one of them was an instrumental, which I think was, I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. The other one was a great song. I didn't know who did it. And it wasn't until years later that I found out who did it. It was Seals and Crofts with a song that didn't get too high on the chart. Say you wanna know what you gotta do to make me forget what you put me through, and I want a chance to prove loving me is everything to you, baby. I give it to you, baby. I give it to you. No one can make me feel like you do. So baby, I'll give it to you. That was Seals and Crofts. And I did not know that was Seals and Crofts until much later, when I got a title strip for that song. And then I go and say, I never heard that song. You know, I go on YouTube to listen to it, see if I liked it. And as soon as I started playing, I said, what? What? Oh my God, that's the song! Oh my God, that's the song that was on the Ampex Custom Duplicating Services cassette. I was like, whoa! Oh, thank you, my friend, thank you. You solved that mystery for me. You know. The other one, the other booth that I went to, was for a jigsaw puzzle for a new Ampex half or quarter inch reel-to-reel machine. It was sort of like a, you know how you have those full page ads in magazines? Well, this was sort of like a full page ad for this tape recorder from Ampex, right? And it was a jigsaw puzzle for this ad. And they were, it was put together with the exception of one piece. And so when you walked up to the table, the thing is, there's a bucket with jigsaw pieces in there. And you stick your hand in and pull out a piece. And if it fits the puzzle, you win the puzzle. I said, cool. I have a feeling every one of the pieces in there is a piece. So it didn't matter which one you grabbed, you always grabbed the right one. And I think he did like me, I don't know. But anyway, of course, I picked the right piece, it fit in the puzzle, and I won a free jigsaw puzzle. But you know what? I go on eBay, I go on Google, I go looking for this damn thing. I can't find it anywhere. I can't find it anywhere. I cannot, because I love that jigsaw puzzle, but I can't find it anywhere. Okay, now. I had a blast. I had a ball. Okay. Now. I don't remember when this happened. One day, one night, coming home from work, Dad was driving along, going home, coming home. And then all of a sudden, he found himself on the other side of the road in opposing traffic, about three towns north of our house. And as soon as my dad realized where he was, he did a complete turnaround and tried to go back home. Now, one thing about my dad was he smoked non-filter Camels, okay? And he was a chain smoker. And one day I was curious because I was smoking also at the time, but I was smoking filter cigarettes. And I would look at the package, and I think it was like 24 grams of tar, something like that, and versus the cigarettes that I was smoking at the time. And so I was curious. I said, damn, these cigarettes must taste pretty good for my dad to eat, for my dad to smoke them as much as I love to eat, or whatever, right? So I took a chance. And there was a pack sitting on the armoire in their bedroom. And I took a cigarette out, and I put it, I try, and I lit it up to smoke it to see what it tasted like. And oh my God, I almost choked. I coughed and I coughed. I said, damn. I stumped it out. I said, oh, Dad. Oh my God, my poor dad. How can you tolerate this? This is such a powerful cigarette. You know. So it concerned my dad. My dad, of course, told my mom. They went to the doctor, and the doctor told my dad that he had cancer from smoking. It was lung cancer that started out in his lungs, and then when there was no place else it could go, it went straight to his brain, and that caused the blackout. So the next thing had to happen is that Dad had to get treatment for the cancer. Now, I don't remember when this was, okay? So he would take Dilaudid and radiation and chemotherapy treatments. And I was the one who basically had to babysit my dad. Since I was going to work with him every day, I was the one to make sure he went to his appointments. And he would have to schedule his appointments on the way to studio. So I would take him there, and I would sit in the waiting room waiting for him to get done. And then once he was done, we'd go straight to the studio. And the chemotherapy and radiation treatments were soon to take a toll on my dad. He started losing his hair. He started looking more gaunt, more forgetful, and he started tending to nod on. And it basically took all the wind out of his sails. And I had a front row seat in watching this strong, powerful man deteriorate into a frail wisp of a man. And I couldn't deal with it. I was having a tough time dealing with it. And I basically had to babysit him to make sure he was okay, that he didn't bump into any walls or anything. And this was the hardest part of the story, of course. And every time that I would drop him off at the house, I'd get back in the car and I'd go to Pizza and Brew in Rye, and Rye, New York, that is, and just have myself, you know, platters, spaghetti and meat sauce and whatever else, and sit with normal people who didn't have the kind of problem that I had to deal with. It was an escape for me to get to get away from that. And there was one time that I was in my bedroom watching a movie on my VHS, and all of a sudden there's a knock on the door. Jimmy, come quick. Come quick, your dad's in the bathroom. I can't get him out. And I just stopped what I was doing. I got on my feet. I raced to the bathroom. And what I saw was a very sad sight. And I'm not going to describe it. So we had to take him to the hospital. And while he was there, it took about a few days before he came back. And when he woke up, he found himself in the hospital with a whole bunch of people looking down on him. And it's like, what happened? And they asked him, do you remember anything over the past, of the past few days? And he, my dad says, vaguely, but it feels like a dream that I just had. So, and it was during this time that my dad and I became very close. And when the chemotherapy and radiation treatments were going on, the doctors told us that the cancer was now in remission. And once it's in remission, it could last a long time. It could last weeks, months, even years. But there was one thing we could count on. When the cancer was no longer in remission, it'll spread through my dad's body like wildfire, and he will die within the week. So we prayed and prayed every day to keep that cancer in remission, because the longer the cancer was in remission, the longer we'd have my dad. Okay? And my mom would tell my dad to sell the studio, to sell Regent Sound Studios before the industry would learn of his sickness, illness. Because if you can sell the studio before the industry learns of your sickness, you will get the value of the studio and not the pieces of equipment. I mean, the value of the studio would be much bigger if my dad sells the studio before the industry learns of his sickness. But once the industry learns of his sickness, then the value of the studio goes down, and all the money that my dad would get would just be the cost of auctioning off all his furniture and equipment. But my dad did not believe that. He believed he would beat this thing. He would keep going and keep going. My dad was a fighter. And so he kept going and going and going. So, but my dad and I became very, very close in this time in our lives. And it's a closeness that I treasure to this day, because we were closest than we've ever, ever been before. And after work, we would stop off somewhere at a restaurant to get dinner. My dad would call my mom, say, you know, don't prepare anything for us. Jeannie and I will grab a bite to eat. You know, and we'd either stop at a pizza place. You know, he'd have a garlic pizza on his half. My half would be ground beef and sausage, you know. And sometimes I'd get a little garlic on my piece, you know, that's okay. But that was his, you know, garlic pizza. Or we'd stop off at a local restaurant. Oh, and that's another thing, right? There was a restaurant in New York City, and this was like well before he moved to 1690 Broadway. And it was on West 56th Street, and we were heading to the garage, and so we stopped off at this one restaurant, and so my dad ordered and I ordered, and I was waiting for my soup, and I was waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, still waiting for the soup, and the waiter comes off and he brings up the salad. He brought me a salad, my dad a salad. My dad is eating the salad. I put my salad aside. Nah, I'm waiting for my soup. I don't want salad. I don't like salad. So I'm still waiting and waiting and waiting. 5, 10, 15 minutes. 20 minutes waiting for my soup. I was really hungry. I said, oh, the hell with this. Give me the salad. I gotta eat something. So I ate the salad. I ate a salad for the very, very first time. And so my dad asked me, well, what do you think? I said, I like it, but I don't like the flavor. So you don't like the dressing that's on the salad. It's a house salad, probably Italian, you know. I said, okay, well, what dressing would I order for a salad? My dad said, well, you like ketchup and you like mayonnaise. So I would say the salads to get would be Russian or Thousand Island, because basically they were the same. So I said, okay. So the next time I was in a restaurant and I would get a salad, I asked for a Thousand Island Russian. It brought out to me. I ate it. I said, hey, I like this. So that's when I started learning to eat salads. Also, while I was at West 56th Street, my dad would always ask me to go get the car. And the car was in the local garage, you know, that you pay for them to keep the car, and then you come back and they'll get it for you, give them a tip, and you drive off. But my dad had a stick-shift car, and I didn't know a damn thing about driving stick. So my dad would tell me to go get the car, and he'd be right there. So they would get the car, and I'd wait. My dad's not here yet. And so the car's sitting there, and it's sort of blocking the way for everybody else to get in their cars. And then my dad would show up, and he'd get the car, we'd drive home. And then one day, he asked me to go get the car, and the garage told me, are you going to take it out? Meaning, am I going to drive it? And drive it out of the garage? I said, no. He says, well, then we're not getting it. We will only get the car if you will drive it out. So, not knowing how to drive a stick, I thought, how difficult could that be, driving a stick, right? So, I learned how difficult it would be driving a stick. I had a tough time driving that car. The car kept stalling. I kept doing something with the clutch. And one time I was finally on West 56th Street, right close to where they was having construction. And there was a crane right in front of me, and the crane was backing up. And I couldn't start the car. I kept hitting the gas. And I says, I don't know what I'm supposed to do with the clutch. I hit the key won't turn, or the engine won't turn over. And I'm like, no. And of course the horn was turned off, so I couldn't honk the horn to say, wait, there's a car back here. You're gonna crash into me, you know? And I started really panicking. I said, Dad, where are you, Dad? Dad, I need you. And then finally, out of the corner of my eye, I looked out the side window, and I rolled down the window. I shouted, Dad! And my dad turned, and he saw me in the car, and he saw that the crane was about to back into me. And I got out, he got in, I got on the other side, and he took us out of there. I'll never forget it. And so the next time my dad wanted to get the car, I told him, Dad, I'm not getting the car. I'm not getting the car. I cannot drive a stick. They won't release it unless you're there to take it out. Okay. So that was that little adventure. Okay. So now back to... now back to the time when Dad was fighting against chemotherapy and radiation treatments, while cancer and remission was going on. And we became very, very close. I really treasured those months that we were together, or that we were close. And we would talk. He would ask me how things were going. There was one time that I had bought a 60mm print of the Concorde Airport 79, and I had never watched it before, but I took a chance on it. Only cost $100, you know. And while others cost a lot more, you know. And I loved it. I said, oh, this is so cool. I gotta watch it again. So I rama film, played it again. And I was so excited about this. I said, I got to tell the folks. I got to tell the family. So, I told everybody. Hey, Dan. All right. My grandparents were there. And so the four of them, mom, dad, grandma, and gramps, came down to the basement and I played them the movie. And I got a lot of positive comments. My grandmother enjoyed it. He said, it was good to watch something good for a change. My grandfather praised this movie, saying that was the first movie he never fell asleep to. And it was either mom or dad who said, wow, what else do you have, Jimmy? I said, wow, now that's praise indeed for my parents. Hey, I won my parents over on my 60mm film collection. Hey, they enjoyed it. They want to know what other films I had. I said, wow, you know. So it was a wonderful time during this time. As much as I hated watching what was doing to my dad, it was a wonderful time because this was the time that dad and I were close and the closest we've ever been. And soon it was starting to affect other areas of my dad's life. My dad was a no-show at NBC a few times until NBC decided not to renew his contract. That broke his heart. The state of New York would not renew his driver's license. That devastated him. And it was then that he realized life was over for him. And so he hired a limo driver by the name of Vern. And Vern was a really nice guy. And whenever I was not available to take him to work, Vern would take him. Or take us, you know. And it really was something else. And then, in the midst of all of this, something amazing happened to my dad. To boost up his morale and his mood and give him a focus and a purpose. And this is where I'll stop now and I'll pick it up next time. So, thanks. Oh yeah, I'm leaving a cliffhanger on right now. Okay, so plus it's getting really hot out here. I want to go inside where it's air conditioning. All right. Okay, so thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. And I'll see you later. And take care and I'll see you soon. Okay.